Around the what?
Around the world.
Oh,
Hey guys, good morning. Happy Sunday. We're so excited for you guys to join with us. We are here in our broadcast Sunday morning. Man, today is going to be an awesome day. Guess what? It's Resurrection Sunday. Praise God. That means that whatever has been dead in your life is coming back alive. Jesus died. He died on Good Friday, and he came back on the third day. We celebrate this day. I'm excited, guys. We have a powerful, powerful compact word to transform your life. It's going to be awesome. We're about to go into a time of worship, and then after worship we're going to go straight into the word, and we're going to have a blast. So guys, get ready. Get out of the couch, get out of your bed. Come on, dust your shoulders off. Let's lift our hands to the Lord, and we're going to get into a time of worship and praise. Come on. God bless you.
See you. shepherd. He goes before me, defender behind me.
Yeah. 'cause you're the way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
Guys, welcome back. Come on, man. I'm excited. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Let's get into this word. Come on, let's go into time of prayer. Father, thank you for every person, every anointed, awesome man and woman of God and the children that are watching today all over the world. Lord, I pray, Lord, as I begin to preach, Lord, that you would move through my mouth, God. Lord, that you would use me as an oracle and that people would get blessed, God. People would be strengthened. Those that are dealing with fear, financial issues, whatever it might be, God, you're going to turn around and put them on top of the world. And we thank you for it. If you believe that, shout hallelujah and give me some Holy Ghost high fives. Praise God. You guys ready to get in the word? Come on, let's grind and let's get this thing done. Come on, it's going to be awesome. Let's go. Matthew chapter 4, 23 through 25 in NLT. Jesus was traveling through the region of Galilee, teaching in the synagogue and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. News went and spread about all Samaria, and the people began to be bringing all those that were sick. And every one of them that had disease and sickness, or if they were demon-possessed or epileptic or paralyzed, he healed them all. Large crowds began to follow him wherever he went, and people from Galilee and 10 towns, Jerusalem, and all over Judea and from the east and Jordan. We go in the book of Acts chapter 10, verse 38, and you know that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Then Jesus went about doing good and healing all those that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we were the apostles, and we witnessed all that he did throughout Jerusalem and Judea, and they put him to death, hanging him on the cross. But God raised him to life on the third day. Then God allowed him to appear, and not just to the general public, but to us also. And then it keeps reading from there. The title of my message today is Good News. Somebody shout good news. Praise God. Man, I know it's a relief to hear some good news. I know around the world right now, it's just bad, bad news. You turn on the TV, you go on your Facebook, you go on your Instagram, and it's just bad news after bad news. But I'm here to tell you that today is good news. Praise God. I want you to tap somebody, shout good news. The Bible is clear. You know, the gospel means good news. And I want to tell you this story. There's a man of God that I know that his brother-in-law, when he was a young child, a young boy, he was in his dad's car going through New York City. And this three-year-old kid wasn't strapped down properly in the truck. And if you've ever been to New York City, there's potholes all over the place. A rough, rough drive. Well, anyways, when he was in the car seat as 3 years old, the window was rolled down and they were going through a bumpy road. And when they went around a turn or whatever, the door swung open and they hit a bump and the kid fell out of the car. I think he fell out the window or he came right out of the car. And he rolled and smashed his head on the side of the curb. Well, immediately they took him to the hospital, took him in intensive care. And for about a day there, they were just looking at the child saying, hey, the kid's not going to live. He's on life support. Well, this family did not know Jesus. They never accepted Jesus before. And it was a Spanish family. And they knew that there was an evangelist, a pastor coming to town. And the dad said, you know what? I'm going to get my kid healed. If God is who he says he is, then I'm going to go to this man of God and I'm going to have him pray for my son to bring him back to life. And so what he did was he found this man of God. He broke through the protocol or whatever, got to the man. And this evangelist was there and he said, hey, evangelist, preacher man, you need to come and pray for my son. He's about to die. The doctor's giving up on him. I don't know what to do. And the evangelist said, I'm going to take my handkerchief and I'm going to pray for it. And then what you're going to do is you're going to put this over top of that child's face. And he's going to come back to life. And so sure enough, that's what the man of God did, because he couldn't. He was preaching that night. So he prayed for this handkerchief and obviously put it on the kid's face. The dad walked in there, put it on the kid's face. And as he went inside the hospital, the mother thought he was doing witchcraft or something. But the awesome great news was that the next morning after he put that handkerchief on him, the kid, as they walked in the room, he was fully awake, eating cereal, watching TV. Praise God. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah. I want to tell you that there's good news today. There is awesome, great news. Again, the word gospel, the gospel means great tidings or glad tidings or good news. Jesus came to bring us good news. This is what Resurrection Sunday is all about. Notice in Acts 10:38, I just read, but it says this, then Jesus went about doing good. And it says this, healing all, praise God. I want you to say he's doing good. Notice that word healing all. It's not just healing people of sickness, but maybe it's a broken heart you're dealing with. Maybe it's fear, whatever it might be. Today marks a new chapter in your life. Listen, God loves you. He's for you. He's not against you today. This is why he came. His mission was a down on the cross. His motive was love. His motive was love because he loves you so much today. So I want you to be encouraged. There is good news coming your way. I want to read this to you, something I wrote down. There's no sickness he can't save you from. There's no debt he can't delete. There's no addiction he can't address. There's no depression he can't destroy. There's no trouble he can't turn around. There's no crisis he can't conquer. There's no problem he can't solve. There's no mountain he can't move. There's no disaster he can't dissolve. There's no hardship that he can't handle. There's no setback he can't set up. There's no crash that he can't stop. And there's no failure that he can't fix. Praise God. We serve an awesome God. I have good news for you today. God specializes in solving an impossible problems. I have good news for you today. God hasn't forgotten you. I have good news for you that he hasn't given up on you. I have good news for you. His name is still El Shaddai, the God that is more than enough. I have good news for you that he is the same Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. I have good news for you. His name is still Jehovah Jireh, the one who sees and provides. I have good news for you that God made heaven and earth in 6 days. In a split second, he can solve your problems. Come on, give him praise and give him glory in the house. Come on, I'm about to do me a shuffle in this beautiful place. Hallelujah. Come on, we serve an awesome God. Come on, give Jesus some thumbs up on Facebook today. Come on, I want you to lift your hands and shout hallelujah. Woo, glory to God. God loves you and he's on your side. Look at Jeremiah 29:11. I love this verse. You guys know it. It says, for I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans of good and not for disaster. Praise God. I want you to grab a hold of that word today to give you a hope and a future. The Bible says in Psalms 39:16-18 in the Passion Translation, every moment you were thinking of me. This is David writing about God, thinking about us and him. How precious and wonderful to your counsel that you cherish me consistently in every thought. Oh God, your desires towards me are more than the grains of sand on every shore. When I wake up every morning, you're still with me. You saw me before I was created and you came to me. Before I'd ever seen the light of day, the numbers of day you have planned for me and were already recorded on a book. I want to tell you there's good news. There's hope for you guys. There's hope for you. I don't care what you're facing. Listen, just about, I don't know how many years ago, maybe 12, 13 years ago, I was a drug addict. My life was a wreck. I was depressed. I was in and out of relationships. My life was falling apart. I had voices coming to my head to kill myself. Man, I felt like no one loved me. I felt like I gave everything and nothing worked out, and I wanted to take my life out. But in the midst of all that, praise God. Woo. This great news, this awesome God who we serve today, who's trying to reach out to you today, he came and rescued me. And that's why I totally abandoned everything, my career, everything. And I said, God, I'm gonna chase after you, because I should have been dead. But this great, awesome news came to me. I was a drug addict. I was an alcoholic. I was a liar. I was a thief, you name it. But when he came in my life, I figured out what I've been missing my whole entire life was just Jesus. And literally, I felt, and even now I feel, the love. The Bible says, for the joy of the Lord that was set before him, this joy, it was you. He loves you. He loves you. That is the good news, that God actually loves you. He cares for you. You mean so much to him today. And he's reaching out with loving arms and saying, come, I'll take care of you. I'll change you. I can heal your broken heart. I can turn things around in your life. And that's what he's going to do. So I'm encouraging you. There's good news for you. There's great news for you. And let's get into this. Point number one, if you are sick, I have good news. Religion tells you that sickness is of God. It's a bunch of garbage. You know, I have kids, and I couldn't imagine beating my kids up and slapping them around and feeding them poison and saying, you know, your dad's just trying to teach you a lesson. Absolutely not. Religion will lie to you. Religion is what killed Jesus, but a relationship with him is different. Look at Mark chapter 5. Verses 25, a woman in the crowd who had suffered many things for 12 years with constant bleeding. She had suffered a great deal of many doctors, and over a year she spent everything that she had to pay them. But she haven't got better, but worse. And then she says this in verse 27. It says, but when she had heard of Jesus, the good news, she came behind him through the crowd and touched his robe. For she said to herself, if I can just touch his robe, I will be healed. And immediately the blood stopped, and she could feel in her body that she had been healed from that terrible illness. Now notice this, it was 12 years. This woman in the Bible was suffering with bleeding for 12 years. How long have you been suffering? Today marks a new day for you. You don't have to suffer any longer. I have good news for you. If you're sick, I have good news. You say, well, Pastor Tony, I'm not sick in my body. I'm sick in my head. I got good news. He can heal your broken heart. He can heal any mental things that are going on emotionally. He's the God of the turnaround. He's the God that's more than enough. Come on, he's an awesome God. So for 12 years, she had this problem. The Bible says that she went to every physician. She went to every doctor. And as she was going there, she spent all her money and rather grew worse. You know, in that timing, when you had something wrong with you, if you had an issue of blood or leprosy or whatever, they kicked you out of the city, so you had to live in the woods. This woman, she might have started out very rich and wealthy and everything was going, and then a storm came and hit her life, a storm of sickness. And that might be you today. You might be dealing with a storm of sickness, but I have good news for you. Jesus still heals today. Come on, he's a healer. He's a deliverer. He's the one that can set you free. Listen, he's the great physician. Hallelujah. And then the Bible says this, but when she encountered Jesus, when she touched the hem of his garment, when she engaged herself in faith, what happened? 12 years were just gone like that. Immediately she was healed. And I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice, if you're dealing with any ailment or sickness in your body, in Jesus' name, be healed. One of my awesome associates, Pastor Eric Gagnon, a good, awesome man of God, one of my great friends, and such an honor to work with him under Dr. Rodney Howard Brown. You know, when he was in the world, he was, you know, a multimillionaire, I think at the age of 23, 24. You know, Porsche 911, had all this money. Obviously, he was in the world. And obviously, he got caught up and, you know, he started having, you know, sex outside of marriage, and he contracted HIV/AIDS. And he was going through a terrible time in his life, and he just rededicated his life to Jesus. Now he goes and gets his blood checked because he's about to get married. And then obviously, you know, the doctor says, hey, I need you to take a seat. He said, what's up, doc? He said, I hate to tell you, but you have HIV/AIDS, and you're basically about to die. Well, check this out. you know, he was distraught. I mean, you think about it. He got his life right now. Everything began to change. And now he's got HIV AIDS. Now, what do you do in a situation like that? Well, he didn't run away from God. He ran to God. He went to a church service, and a priest, he said, the guy, you know, it was like a Catholic church or whatever. God bless the Catholics. But he said he went to this Catholic service or Lutheran service, and the man was dressed like a woman, but looked like a man. They called him mother, but he looked like a mother, but he was like a father, whatever they call it. And he said he took oil and he placed it on his head. And he said as he put oil on his head, he felt like a big burning heat go through his body. He got tested, and the doctor was shocked. He said, man, we got to test you again. He tested him again and again and again. And now God has completely healed him. Come on, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on. Good news if you're sick today. Come on. If there's any element, any problem in your body, in the name of Jesus, we command that sickness to leave. Look what the Bible says in Psalms 147, verse 3. He heals the brokenhearted, and he binds up their wounds. 1 Peter 2:24, he himself bore our sins on his body on the cross so that we might be dead to sins and live by righteousness, by whose wounds or stripes you have been healed. The Bible says in Psalms 146, verse 8, the Lord gives sight to the blind, and the Lord lifts up those who are bowed down, and the Lord loves the righteous. The Bible also says in Psalms 107, 20, he sent his word to heal them and rescued them from the grave. Hey, what grave are you facing today? God can rescue from it. I got good news. So if you're sick, hey, you got good news now. You know, I know a lot of people have gone to the doctors and heard bad news, but you can come to the great physician is Jesus and hear great news, and he can turn it around in Jesus' name. Number two, point number two, if you're in need of finances, I have good news. You know, a lot of people are saying that the market is crashing and all these crazy stuff. But listen, I'm about to tell you what God has to say about it. I got some good news for you. You know, religion tells you that, you know, to be religious, you have to be broke. That's a lie from the devil. They say money is evil. No, the love of money, the lust of money is the root of all evil. But money is not evil. If money was evil, then Jesus was carrying around evil all with him wherever he went. That's a lie from the enemy. But notice this in 2 Corinthians verse 8. It says this, chapter 8, verse 9, you know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that through his poverty you might become rich. The word rich is clear. It means wealthy, abundantly, and material resources. You say, well, what has it got to do with money? Why is the church always talking about money? Why? Because you're called to be, you're blessed to be a blessing. The Bible commands us to feed the poor. The Bible commands us to take care of the widows. And if we don't have money, how can we take care of anybody? But I believe God is going to give you ideas in this time. I believe God is going to strengthen you. I believe that you're not going to go under, but you're going to go over. You're not going to lose your job. You're going to increase in your work. God is going to give you wisdom and witty inventions in Jesus' name. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you have that you might have life and life more abundantly. Another translation says, the thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life. Proverbs 10:22 says, the blessing of the Lord makes one rich and adds no sorrow with it. The Bible says in Philippians 4:19, he shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Listen, guys, good news, good news, good news. If you need financial assistance, if you need help, I'm telling you there's good news on its way, and his name is Jesus. Praise God. Number three. If you're in fear, I have good news. If you're in fear, if you're going through tormenting, if you're going to sleep and you don't know if you're going to have a job the next day, if you don't know if you're going to get sick or not, or the world's going to come to an end, I have great news for you. Deuteronomy 31, verse 6, be strong. I'm talking to you today. Don't be weak, be strong. I didn't say physical strength. I'm taking mental strength in the word. God is saying to us, be strong and be of good courage. Fear not. Neither be afraid of them. This is what he was telling Joshua. For the Lord your God, it is he that goeth with thee. He will not fail thee nor forsake thee. God is not going to give up on you. God is not going to turn his back on you. You know, God, I said this during the week's broadcast, but God, when a tragedy comes, he doesn't go and hide out in a bunker. Jesus, the angels, they all go to Walmart, get a bunch of beans, and they go hide out, and they wait for channel, you know, the CNN to tell them that everything's cleared, you can come out your bunker. No, that's not the God that we serve. Come on, he's an almighty God. Listen, he helped the children of Israel through the Red Sea. He helped Daniel through the lion's den. Come on, he knocked Goliath out. Come on, God is an awesome God. He helped Noah build that ark. Listen, the same God that went through them, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Come on, you don't have to be afraid of anything. Listen, as a Christian, yes, we use wisdom, but guess what? The greater ones on the inside of us, we don't have to fear anymore. There's no fear that lives in here. Can you say amen? Look at Isaiah 41, verse 10. The Bible says that God said, "Fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with my right hand and my righteousness." Isaiah 41 verse 13 says, "For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear." Look at this. "I will help you." Come on, I need you to dance in the devil's face. Get a victory dance. Ooh, touchdown. I remember when I was a kid, man, every time I scored, I would go nuts. I think my mom would be like, "Son, you're kind of bragging too much." But listen, I can brag about Jesus now. How about that? How about you do a little victory dance? Come on. He said, "I will help you." Guess what? Help is on this way. Help is already there in your house, wherever you might be. Hallelujah. I have good news for you. Good, good, good news. Look what the Bible says right here. In Psalms 118, verses 6, "The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?" Or what can men do to me? Men can't do anything if God is with you. Look at this. Psalms 23, I love this. Verse 4, it says, "Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Deuteronomy 31, verse 8, "For the Lord himself will go before you and will be with you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." That's what God is saying today. Hallelujah. And I know that devil is pumping fear right now. He wants us to panic. He wants us to freak out. He wants us to be tormented. He wants us just to be so afraid. But I'm here to tell you, you do not have to be afraid. I have good news. God is with you. Come on. The creator of heaven and earth is with you. The uncreated creator. Come on. The God Almighty, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Come on. The one, hallelujah, that has no number, has no age. This God is on our side and he loves you today. Hallelujah. And let's get into this last point. I hope you're enjoying this. My last point is this. If you're in need of life insurance, notice I said life insurance, I have good news for you. Now let me talk about this for a moment. You know, wise people plan, right? And I know you're wise watching today. Every one of you are. You little wise yous. You wouldn't be watching this broadcast if you weren't wise. But notice people in life, they plan for everything. They have house insurance. Why do you have house insurance? Because if your house floods or catches on fire, you're gonna have the insurance pay for it, right? Who has car insurance? Why? Because if you get in a wreck or something happens, guess what? Your car will be taken care of. But I'm here to tell you that if you're in need of life insurance, I'm not talking about when you're old and you get your house taken care of and, you know, they feed you at the nursing home, which none of you guys will be in the nursing home in Jesus' name. They might be watching from the nursing home. God bless you. Good to have you today. Praise God. But again, I want to talk about eternal life insurance. That's what this Sunday is all about. It's Resurrection Sunday. The Bible says, "What profit a man if he gain the whole world and he loses his own soul?" You can have a massive house. You can have tons of money. You can have the best marriage. You can have the best kids. You can have the best degree. But if you gain this whole world but yet lose your soul, what does it profit you? What is life really about? The greatest part of life is getting to know your creator, the one and only God Almighty. This world is passing by. It's like the Bible calls it a puff of smoke. The Bible calls like it, he likens the earth and the time that we spend, it's like the dew of the grass. You know, when you go on the grass in the morning, it's wet, but by the afternoon, it's gone. And it's saying that that's how our life is going to be. Look what the Bible says. I love this verse, and you guys know it. But John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Look at this good news. "For God has not sent his son into the world to condemn the world." See, that's the key, guys. God is not condemning anybody. He's not, you know, people think of God, of some guy on the street corner saying, "You're going to die and burn in hell." That's not God. The Bible is clear. He didn't come to condemn people. The Bible says, "But that the world through him might believe." Now, the other side is this. "Him that believeth not, and he that believeth not is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name and the only begotten Son. So the Bible's clear. It's basically saying, if you don't believe, then you're already condemned. No one needs to condemn you. You already condemn yourself. But those that believe, God has not come to condemn you. He loves you. Listen, you might be watching for the first time. You probably haven't been to church in a while. Or you might be in church all the time. Either way, God loves you. He cares so much about you. He would not die 2,000 years ago on a cross. He didn't have to leave his throne. He didn't have to leave his nice, beautiful kingdom to come down like a human. I mean, I liken it unto this. Look what Jesus did. Jesus literally, imagine you being like a royal king or like a president of a nation. And literally you say, you know what? I'm going to become an ant and go down to the ant kingdom. And then I'm going to allow them to spit on me, pull my hair out, put thorns in me, and crucify me to a stick down on the ground. And I'm going to die for them. And I'm going to take their penalty, their guilt, their shame, their adultery, their lies, and I'm going to put it on me, and I'm going to go down to hell and blow up and then steal the keys from the devil and give it back to them so they can come. That's how much God loves you. Resurrection Sunday is because he loves you. God loves you. The Bible says that God so loved the world. He loves you. Man, I feel it right now. Woo, glory. God loves you. You're important. You mean so much to him. Come on, he's reaching out to you through the camera. You say, man, I feel God when you're talking. Brother, listen, I'm nothing. God is everything. Listen, you can ask my family. I was ADD. I was taking medicine, all types of stuff. This is totally God speaking to you right now. And he loves you, and he has an awesome plan for your life. If you're needing life insurance, I got good news. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death in Romans 6:23, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So what do you have to do to get life insurance? It's simple. I got good news. It's very simple. Repent and believe. Repent means you're changing the way you're thinking, and if you're doing something, then turn from it. It's not that hard. God will give you the grace. God will give you the grace. A lot of people think, well, Pastor Tony, I'm not going to church because, you know, I'm still drinking, I'm still partying, and I don't know if I can commit like that. Listen, guys, God is too good not to commit like that, and God says, come as you are. Listen, you come as you are, and then God begins to work on you. You know, when I first got saved, I was still smoking weed here and there, and I'd feel so guilty after I do it. I'm like, oh, man, I'm an idiot. And I'd hear the devil saying, yeah, you're an idiot. You're no good, and no one loves you. And then I would hear God say, son, I know you messed up, but I love you. Come on, let's keep it moving. He's so good. I'm sorry, I'm getting messed up a little bit. Why? Because he loves you. Like, you think about it. My kids, a couple months ago, they were eating cereal, and my oldest took her cereal and just smacked it, man. Milk went everywhere. I mean, there was milk. I mean, it was severe. So guess what? I popped her and told her to go in her room. But she came back out, and I told her to apologize. We cleaned it up together. And listen, literally, like, in 3 minutes, I forgot about it. Why? Because I love her. Yes, she was in trouble. She was in timeout. But I didn't forsake her for dumping the thing over. Guess what? Guess what else my kids did? They became graffiti artists at the house. My parents know all about that. I guess I'm reaping what I sowed as a kid. So my kids one day decided that they wanted to paint the walls. And they smeared the walls with all types of crowns and markers. And guess what? Was Daddy upset? Yes. But only for a moment. I repainted the house. I was happy. I got over it within like maybe 20 minutes, 25 minutes. Let me just say, maybe 30 minutes. But listen, I still love my kids. And if I see them right now, I'll kiss their face off. How much more God? God loves you today. You know, I want to end with this in Luke 23:39. This is when Jesus was on the cross. And a lot of times, you guys, when you go past churches, you'll see three crosses. And the depiction is, really, in those three crosses, Jesus is on the center, and on the left and the right is actually the world. And I'm going to show you this in a moment. The Bible says one of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed and said, you're the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself to us. Why you're all that? Verse 40 says, but the other criminal protested, do you not fear God even when you have been sentenced to death? We desire death for our crimes, but this man, he's talking about Jesus, hasn't done anything wrong. Then he said to Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Jesus replied, assuredly, I say to you, with me, you'll be in paradise. Now notice that the two types of people, Jesus is in the center. On one side, the guy is saying, you know, yeah, God, if you're real, blah, 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 blah. When he's literally on his way to the grave. Now, I don't know about you, but that guy is an idiot. I don't mean to call him an idiot, but he just is an idiot. Why? You are dying and you're arguing with the one that can save you. Now notice that that could be one side of the world. Then the other side was saying, hey, listen, God, I'm sorry. I messed up, you know, and I need your help. What did Jesus respond? He said, today you'll be with me in paradise. What was he saying? Because you accepted me, you're going to be up in heaven. And that was the resurrection. That was the death, burial, and resurrection. Again, and I'll close with this. His mission was to die for you. That's why we celebrate Resurrection Sunday and Good Friday. Good Friday is when he died. And then the third day he rose, which is Resurrection Sunday. And his mission was what? His mission was that he had to come and die for you to pay the price to connect you back to God the Father. Then his motive, like I said earlier, was love. He loves you. What made him do what he did is because he loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you greater than a father could love a son. He loves you greater than a husband can love a wife. He loves you greater than you love your children. I'm telling you, God's love is dangerous. It is so amazing when you tap into God's love. Everything on the inside of you will connect, and you'll find your fulfillment when you encounter God's love. And the Bible says clear, it says in the book of Revelations, that God stands at the door and he knocks. Now, he's not talking about a normal house. He's talking about this house. He's been knocking at the door of your heart, and he's asking you, will you open and will you let me in? Today, I want you to bow your head and close your eyes. I got good news. He loves you. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, every person on the sound of my voice, I pray, Lord, that you would encourage them today, strengthen them wherever they might be. Lord, I thank you that they have good news all over them, that, Lord, when they wake up, when they go to sleep, that no evil, no calamity will come nigh them. Even in Psalms 91, verse 10, no evil will befall them, neither any plague come nigh their dwelling. Now, you're watching this morning. Let me ask you a question. If you die today, where would you spend eternity? There's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. You do not have to go to the devil's hell. It was never meant for human mankind. It was meant for the devil and the fallen angels, those that disobeyed God. And that's why we're in the mess that we're in today. But thank God, God turned it around by dying on a cross and raising on the third day. You've never accepted Jesus. Guys, listen, life insurance, that's what we talked about earlier. It's so important. It's the greatest thing ever. You know, there was a man that was a multimillionaire, millionaire. And he got all this money. He retired. He went down to South Florida. He went out fishing. And guess what happened? The first day of his brand new massive yacht, he worked all these years and had all this money, he got bit by a saltwater crocodile. He got pulled in the water and he died. Now notice, he worked his whole life to get a nice boat, to get out on the beautiful water, and to get ripped inside the water. And who knows where this man is at right now. There is life after death. So that's number one. Number two, you might have gone to church or you know about Jesus, but you're not living for him like you should. Maybe you're in unforgiveness. Maybe you're in bitterness, jealousy. Maybe in lust. Maybe in adultery. Maybe in a fornication. Whatever it is, God's calling you back home. You got to repent. You got to turn from that. And God will give you help today. And he will, and he loves you. Now listen, if you fit in any of those categories, I want to pray with you for you. I just want you to lift your hands in your room. Hallelujah. Say, Pastor Tony, please pray for me. And with your hand lifted, I want you to close your eyes and just repeat the simple prayer with me and just say this. Say, Jesus, I ask you today to come into my heart, to forgive me of all my sins, and to make yourself so real to me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Give me a heart for your word and give me a passion to love other people. In Jesus' precious name. Hey, make sure you check us out very, very soon. We're going to be doing an awesome, amazing church here in Maryland. We're going to be doing revivals all over Maryland. You can check us out. You can check out riverchurchbaltimore.com. And my wife's going to come on next. But if you want to give and be a blessing, listen, we have to reach the lost. We have to get the message of hope out. You can check us out. If you go to River Church Baltimore, you can scroll all the way to the bottom, and you can be a blessing. And remember, when you give, it will be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Also, a couple other announcements. We're going to be live, and we're going to be going with our broadcast Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. You can come check us out. It's going to be starting at 6 p.m. and we're gonna have an awesome time. Listen, I'm teaching on the God that never fails, and I hope you're encouraged. We love you. Happy Resurrection Sunday, and service is not over.
everybody. Welcome back again. I just want to give you a very quick encouraging word that I had in my spirit for you this Sunday morning. I want to share with you and encourage you in your giving this morning and our tithes and our offerings. And the title of the sermon that I'm going to share with you guys is The Power of the Seed. Somebody say the power of the seed. Say there is power in my seed this morning. Hallelujah. I want you to take out your Bibles, your sword right here, the power of God. I want you to take it out right now and go to the Gospel of John chapter 12, and we're going to look at verse 23 through verse 25, and it reads, "And Jesus answered them, saying, The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." Somebody say much fruit. "He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal." I'm here to tell you today, there is power in your seed. We can see in this demonstration that Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he was demonstrating to them that he was that seed that was to die into the ground, that we're celebrating today, Resurrection Sunday. And Jesus was prophesying what was to come, that he was going to be giving his body as the seed in that ground, and that it would bring forth much fruit. So the first point I want to give you on the power of the seed is that the seed is substantial. The first point is that the seed is substantial, and the substantial seed was Jesus, the man that was going to give his life for all of the world. Right here, you can see I have this beautiful little bowl here of fruit. And I want to talk about this bowl of fruit because the fruit did not start a fruit. This fruit did not begin as a fruit, but the fruit started as a seed. Everybody knows that this is an apple. But if I just showed you the little tiny brown seed that this apple started as, you would wonder, well, how did that come about? There's power in your seed. The seed is substantial. If I take this seed and I plant it into the ground, and then God causes the windows of heaven to open and rain upon that seed, it will bring forth beautiful fruit that we can bite, that we can enjoy, that we can live off of, that can sustain us. So the power of the seed is substantial. The second point that I want to give you in this passage is that a seed by itself is powerless. It stands alone. It's powerless. If I was to take that little brown seed of this apple and put it away in my clothing drawer, or stick it in the refrigerator, or take that brown seed and flush it in the toilet, it would never produce fruit. So the power of a seed is in its death. When a seed is planted into the ground, it actually breaks open and sprouts up and springs forth beautiful fruit that we can enjoy. The third thing that I want to tell you is that one seed has the power to bring forth miracle fruit and miracle harvest in your life. We see here that Jesus is the incorruptible seed. We see in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, "Bring born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God that lives and abides forever." So Jesus is that incorruptible seed. He's that seed that went to the cross for all of humanity and shed his blood so that we could have everlasting life, so that our corruptible could put on incorruptible, so our mortal could put on immortal, so we can have a glorified body, hallelujah, and meet him in the air and have life eternal. I'm here to tell you, there's power in your seed. You might say, well, what is my seed? I'm talking about your tithes and your offerings, your giving today. You know, love gives. The Bible says in John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. God loves you, and he loves you so much he sent his one and only son to be that seed, to be that incorruptible seed that would die to the things of this world in order to gain his life. You know, that's why Jesus said in verse 25 of this verse, you have to lose your life to gain it. If you try to find your life in the things of this world, you'll lose it. But if you find your life in him, you'll gain it. If you find your life in his kingdom, you'll gain it. And one of the ways of the kingdom that we're talking about today is in sowing and reaping, in giving, in letting that seed die in the ground so that heaven could rain on it and bring forth fruit that others can eat off of. So today we're gonna bless, be a blessing to the kingdom of God. We're going to give into the grounds of the kingdom of God. Good ground, good soil, that the ground that never dies, that never becomes obsolete, that never fades away. You know, the Bible says in Matthew 6:33, if you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these other things that the Gentiles, that the world so heavily seeks and craves after, the Bible says it will come up beside you in abundance. So today I want to encourage you to be a blessing. Go to River Church Baltimore. You can give by Venmo. You can give by Cash App. You can give with credit card, secure it through PayPal. And I want to encourage you in this, that if you're a member of another church, make sure you pay your tithe to your storehouse of faith. Make sure you be a blessing to the church that you are a member. And even still today, I just want to encourage you to be a blessing. Give an offering to River Church Baltimore. Maybe you don't have a home church. Maybe this is going to be your church. Bring your tithes and offerings and be a blessing to River Church Baltimore. You know, next month we're going to be looking for a building for the church. Hallelujah. We're also going to be looking at venues all across the greater Baltimore and Annapolis area for the 5-week revival. This summer we're kicking off outreach crusades. Be a part of the harvest happening in this greater Baltimore area and all of America through Nations Ablaze Ministries. Hallelujah. We're going to take a quick break and we're going to come right back to communion. So go ahead and grab a piece of bread, grab some grape juice, and join my husband and I for communion. And as you go and get that, go ahead and give your seed on riverchurchbaltimore.com and be a blessing. And we'll see you back in a few minutes.
Hey guys, welcome back. We're going to get in communion. You guys can go run to your wherever your cabinets are and grab a piece of bread, and obviously we'll get some juice. But as you're going to do that, I want to encourage you in this verse in Matthew 26, 26 through 28. The Bible says, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he began to give thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood in the covenant, which was poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. It's simple. This bread is a symbol. It's a symbolic symbol as a Christian that when you eat this, you're eating and indulging God's body. The body was bruised. It was beaten. It was torn for us. And as we accept this body, we accept healing in our body. We accept the anointing, the power of God to touch our physical body. Any of you guys dealing with sickness or disease or anything, this is crucial. Communion is so crucial. It's not a religious thing that we do, but it's actually powerful. Jesus, you know, told us to do this. And then the Bible says that this cup, this juice, represents his blood, the blood of forgiveness for sins, to wash any stain of guilt, shame, condemnation, all of it. By taking the cup, you're remembering that Jesus paid the price for that. So let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your body, this bread representing your body. Thank you, Lord, you didn't have to do it, but you did it. Praise God. Thank you for 2,000 years ago coming in a human body and dying for us, God. And Lord, we thank you for it. And Lord, every person under the sound of my voice, those that are watching, I speak healing and life in the bodies in Jesus' mighty name. You can eat the bread. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's pray for the cup. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your blood. This cup represents your blood that was poured out for the whole entire world, God. Thank you, Lord, that it forgives us of all sin and guilt. Lord, that when you look on us, you don't see our sins, but you see the blood.
Yes.
And Lord, thank you that your blood is covering our family, our house, our vehicles, our workplace, whatever we do, every organ in our body. Thank you, Lord. The devil cannot touch us because of your blood. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise God. Well, again, guys, thank you for joining. Man, we had an awesome time today. I'm really happy that you guys came and joined us. Please like and share. And then also, again, you can check out River Church Baltimore. Scroll down to the bottom. You can check out where to give. Then also this week, we're going to be live, and we're going to be smacking it Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Make sure you guys join. And then we'll see you next Sunday. Guys from Maryland, we love you so much. Have an awesome, awesome Sunday. God bless you.
Around the world?
Around the world.
Pastor Tony, so good to see you. God is doing some awesome things. Guess what? We're in Baltimore.
That's right.
The Big B-more, the Charm City. Guys, we're so pumped and excited. God is on the move. God is doing massive, massive things. listen, about 2 years ago, the Lord spoke to me in an audible voice. I was waking up one day in Tampa, Florida, at my house, and literally I heard God's voice, and he told me to go audibly. I heard it audibly, and I knew he was telling me to go into the city. And years later, I ended up here, and now I'm here. And just in January the 3rd, the Lord gave me a vision. And in the vision, I saw the skyline just like this behind me. And in the skyline, as I stood on the highway, I saw water going through my legs. And the Lord told me to start the river at Baltimore Church, to raise up a colorless army that would not bow their knee to the spirit of Jezebel, a fearless and a faceless. And that's what we're dealing with in the city, dealing with a lot of racism, a lot of crazy stuff. But guess what? Jesus is the answer. We saw it in Tampa under Dr. Ronnie's Howard Brown's ministry, how God used literally him and the staff and us to shake the whole city. The crime completely dropped, and that's what's going to happen here. So you stay tuned, guys. This is going to be off the hook, off the charts. We're about to do revivals back to back. We got literally 5 weeks of revivals. We're looking for venues right now. Listen, if you're anywhere in the Maryland area, D.C., even Virginia, you can come out and be a part of it. Connect with us. You can private message me. And listen, it's not about the efforts of one, but it's the efforts of all of us joining together and bringing this end time harvest. We're so excited. Thank you guys for watching tonight. You can check us out on our website, and we'll have the link below. You can click it. We love you guys so much. Have an awesome, awesome night. God bless you.
Around the world?
Around the world!